It is a joy to be here with all of you for the next 3 days. I hope very much that we can have an engaging conversation, something more than me talking and you scribbling notes, but actually an exchange with each other so that together we can talk about governance and related issues in our Waldorf schools. The reason that there are people here from as many schools as there are in a place that's not necessarily easy to come to is because governance in our schools is not easy. Oh, I'm sorry. Who is it easy for here? Okay. It's a struggle. So let's start perhaps with this question of what are some of the common or pressing issues that seem to arise in our schools? Someone got something that...
Qualified faculty.
Okay. Yeah. What else?
Whose job is what?
So maybe that's a structure question. What else?
Just throw out communication.
Communication, yep. Absolutely. Others?
Shared responsibilities.
Okay. And more?
Transition from founders to a more mature school.
Can I call that growth?
Okay.
Say what?
Discipline.
Discipline. Yep. Okay, well, I want to share a list that someone with a lot of experience in working with organizations came up with. A gentleman that some of you may know, Scott Peck. He was the gentleman who wrote The Different Drum. And he has a list that I think in some ways is comforting because it makes us recognize that the issues that we have in our schools are no different than the issues that are found in any organization or any intentional community. So he says that the most frequent areas where trouble comes into an organization first has to come in the area of size. And that can be changing size as well. It comes in the area of structure. How do we want to be organized? It has to do with authority. Who's in charge and who gets to say, right? Who gets to say who gets to say? Inclusivity, right? Intensity. How much interpersonal contact is required? The more interpersonal contact we require, sometimes the harder it is, seemingly. Individuality. Is there a place for it? Commitment. I've been here a really long time. I'm clearly more committed than you are. That's not anthroposophic, right? Immediately cutting out those who don't get to be included. Task definition. So let's get clear about what it is that we're going to do. And also, oftentimes, trouble emerges in the area of ritual. So what are the rituals that we have in our organization? What are the things that we do in an ongoing way to create our culture? So interesting that so many of the things that he mentions as sort of being the generic areas of trouble in an organization are very similar to the kinds of troubles that we have in our own Waldorf schools. Now, in our Waldorf schools, we've chosen to operate organizationally in a couple of ways. We tend to embrace non-hierarchical decision making. We like to make decisions using consensus. We have a number of things that we do that are not efficient. They don't allow us to make quick and easy decisions or to move ahead rapidly, but they do something else. They force us to meet each other. They force us to explore things together until we can find a common way forward. So while they are not necessarily efficient processes, they can be effective in the long term in terms of building the organization. So I thought maybe we could start by just looking at a couple of thoughts that Rudolf Steiner shared about organization and governance. He actually did have some. Goes back. And maybe we can just quickly go through the room and just read one quote at a time and share these with each other. So Amy, would you read the first?
Sure. We must be completely conscious that we have to accomplish a great cultural deed in every sense of the word.
And Steve?
The success of this cultural deed is in your hands. Thus, you have much responsibility in working to create an example. So much depends upon the success of this deed. The Waldorf School will be living proof of the effectiveness of the anthroposophical orientation toward life. It will be a unified school in the sense that it only considers how to teach in the way demanded by the human being, by the totality of the human essence. We must put everything at the service of achieving this goal.
Obviously, the Waldorf School can be successful only if it is completely inspired by the spirit that aspires toward the threefold nature of the social organism. What we strive for here is a transformation of the present social configuration.
Therefore, we will organize the school not bureaucratically but collegially, and will administer it in a republican way. In a true teacher's republic, we will not have the comfort of receiving directions from the school board. Rather, we must bring to our work what gives each of us the possibility and the full responsibility for what we have to do.
Right.
We can create a replacement for the supervision of the school board as we form this preparatory course and through the work receive what unifies the school. We can achieve that sense of unity if we work with all diligence.
At the beginning of culture, humanity strives to create social arrangements in which the interests of the individual are sacrificed for the interest of the whole. Later, developments lead to a gradual freeing of the individual from the interests of the community and to an unfolding of individual needs and capacities.
The healthy social life is found when in the mirror of each human soul, the whole community finds its reflection, and when in the community, the strength of each one is living.
So there we have it. We must be completely conscious that our work in a Waldorf school is a great cultural deed. It's one of the reasons maybe it feels hard. Great cultural deeds don't come easily. And also that the Waldorf School can be successful only if it is completely inspired by the spirit of the threefold social organism. So if our schools aren't completely inspired by the threefold social organism, they aren't truly successful. So do we all know what that means? Do we understand how that manifests itself in our schools? Do we know what we're striving for so that we can actually create this imagination that Steiner had for our Waldorf schools? That's one of the questions we're going to try and explore here this morning. Governance. What is it? Thoughts?
It's creating form to a group.
Mm-hmm. What else? Other than the thing we complain about, right?
Right? It's those people that make the decisions. And
yeah, it's those people, fault. Right? And it's their fault. Those are the ones we blame. What else is governance?
Figuring out how we figure things out.
Right? Exactly. What else?
Doing the things that we figure out.
Okay. So the implementation. Other thoughts about governance, what it really is?
It's almost, it can be at least a kind of taking care of everyone.
Mm-hmm.
An overview and trying to take care of a defined group.
That's what I was going to say. It's the vessel that holds the organism.
Right. All right, so I'll give you a couple of thoughts. Some of these may ring true for you. Governance, decisions that define expectations, grant power, and verify performance. It relates to consistent management, cohesive policies and processes, and the decision rights for a given area of responsibility. It's the administration and process-oriented elements of governing. It can be the traditions and institutions through which authority is exercised, including the process by which our leaders are selected, how they're monitored, and how they're replaced. It has to do with the formulation and implementation of sound policy. It describes how we're going to use the institution's resources, manage the organization's purpose, its problems, and affairs. You know, all of these things are different ways of coming at it. We're very good about complaining that we don't have good governance or our governance isn't really serving us well. But in order to make that statement, we have to be clear about what governance actually is. And so I'd really like to suggest to you that for our schools, it's the set of processes, customs, policies, laws, and even institutions that affect the way people direct, administer, or control an organization. It's a system of structures, operating and controlling an organization with a view to achieving its long-term strategies. So if our long-term strategy is to educate children in a way that clearly manifests this spirit of the threefold organism, that's what we're trying to get to as our end state. It is something more than just making sure that we have an artistically inspired curriculum. It's not enough to say we provide solid academics that are artistically digested. We're really aspiring for something more. We are aspiring to nothing less than social change. If there's a reason that it feels hard in our Waldorf school, it's because Rudolf Steiner really set very high expectations for us in that particular area. Are you guys with me so far? Yeah? Okay. So, the goal of education is so that people can become free and independent. And our social mission in our Waldorf schools is to advance human development so that we can build a better society. So, again, lofty goals, which we hope to achieve one student at a time, one lesson at a time, one day at a time here in our schools. So let's talk just one more minute, if we can, about one of the things that I think makes governance and organizational life in our Waldorf schools a little bit difficult. I remember when I first came in as a new parent to Waldorf schools 20, 7 or 8 years ago. And it seemed like everybody else had the secret book, right? And they hadn't remembered to give it to me as a new parent. But it was clear that there was a legacy at work here. There were certain expectations and values that were alive in the organization. And I thought that it would be really important for someone to write them down. Perhaps if we wrote them down, we could then share them with our other colleagues, new people as they come into the school. We could share them with parents and so on, and give people some sort of a shared imagination for what we're trying to achieve and how we're going to go about it. So some of the legacy points that I've sort of thought about over the years include the fact, as we said, we're working to provide an education for healthy and free human beings. That's an easy starting point. But we want an education that's free of state control. That was the original inspiration. I'd like to suggest that these days we also want an education that's free of the control or influence of business. Businesses and governments both have an interest in creating a certain kind of person as the product of education, a person who is either a good citizen or a person who's a good worker, right? Very different than the impulse of our work in the cultural sphere, where we're hoping to create free and independent human beings who can go make a difference if they choose to in the realm of government or in the realm of economics and finance and business, but not to create workers or citizens per se. Our Waldorf schools place a premium on being self-administered. So we even resist sometimes joining an association like OSNA, you know, or what have you. We put a lot of emphasis on trying to manage things ourselves. We need to remember that our Waldorf schools are laboratories. Now, that sounds awful, doesn't it? I mean, cold and sterile. A lab is not necessarily a place many of us want to be. I avoided science at all costs. You know, 1 year biology in high school, I was done. But I'd like to suggest to you that a laboratory is something a little bit different, that it's actually a place where it's safe to experiment. Can we create, both over the next 3 days here, and also in our Waldorf schools going forward, places where it is safe for us to experiment together, to try things, to share them with our colleagues, to celebrate the successes and the breakthroughs, to recognize the things that we've attempted to do that haven't worked quite correctly? Can we create that kind of an environment in our Waldorf schools? We use forms in our schools that recognize the importance of the human encounter. So therefore, non-hierarchical decision-making, consensus decision-making, those kinds of things. It forces us to come together and meet each other. Our long-term goal is to build a new society. That's an interesting statement because we don't have a particular social agenda other than helping humankind develop so that it's ready to move forward into the future. But it's not a political agenda, it's not a religious agenda, it's not an economic agenda. And yet we want to create students who can be the citizens of tomorrow's world and who can create the social change that is going to be needed. We also, in our Waldorf schools, recognize that we are co-creators with the spirit, that we cannot do our work without making a conscious connection with the spiritual world, and that we need to, on a regular basis, ask for the help of the spiritual world to inform and inspire us in our work. So that's a very different legacy than what you might find in traditional education today. The emphasis in mainstream schools today is on critical thinking. emphasis critical. It's an approach that encourages the sowing of doubt, right? So it's a sort of a negative experience. If we look towards business, we see that advertising today really plays on our likes and our dislikes, our sympathies and antipathies, right? And business encourages egoism. So we have all of these sort of antisocial forces that are being played up right now in all three realms of society. This negative force, these antisocial forces, though, actually are coming to fruition at this time because they're the what makes it possible for us to move forward to the next level of social and human development. When I develop that kind of thinking, it's also possible for me to be involved in true self-consciousness. Right? So it's only when we apply that critical thinking to ourself that it becomes a healthy deed rather than one that's destructive of our relationships with other people, with other organizations, with others in the world. So we can't escape the fact that our sympathies and antipathies are at play here. But I think that we can be thankful that we have them and that we can take a moment to live in the other person's thoughts and feelings as we move our work together in our Waldorf school. So what is this threefolding thing that Steiner says has to really inspire everything that we do here? And so that any person who comes and looks at our Waldorf school says, I clearly see that there's something important. Whoops. Sorry, that was the not good eraser. Something that's happening here. So, I should tell you too that one of the rules of the road for the next 3 days is no anthroposophical jargon unless we've already defined the term. So if I say something that somebody says, what are you talking about? Call me on it, all right? I will try to speak as much as I can in plain English so that no one gets left behind or feels excluded because you didn't get the secret manual. This is the universally recognized anthroposophical bathtub. We love this drawing. So if we start off and say that this is a time drawing, then we're going to start off recognizing that man was born into paradise. It's a very universal form, not a religious picture. When you're in paradise, we can think of our Hebraic history, Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden with God. Man was in direct contact with God. They had conversations, right? They talked to each other directly. There was no separation between God and man. Man didn't even see himself as being separate from God. You know, God and I are one, it reads. Then, very early on, there was a bite of an apple. Everything changed. So immediately, Adam and Eve are aware of themselves as separate from God, as incarnated individuals. They're aware of themselves for the first time, and they hide from God and conceal their nakedness, right? Oh my God, he can see me, right? And I'm not one with him anymore. Imagine how incredibly painful it was to be separated from God in this way. Their whole being, I'm sure, longed for nothing more than to be reunited, to return to this oneness with the social with the spiritual world. Now, Steiner describes that change and a whole series of subsequent changes as the evolution of social consciousness. Steiner's not the only person who wrote about it. If you want to read a lengthy article by a modern day social observer, you can Google Jay Early and see a very long treatise that he wrote on this, that it spells it out in great detail. He's not an anthroposophist, but many social scientists recognize that man has evolved in this way over time. So Steiner describes actually seven stages of human development. You may hear them referred to as cultural epochs or epochs. But it's just referring to developmental periods. If you get heavily into anthrospeak, they're referred to the seven post-Atlantean epochs, which means nothing more than periods of human development after the Great Flood. So, trying to just make sure that we all have the same language here. So, the first period Steiner called the Indian period. This is not Indians, these are ancient Indians. And he described this as a period of development where man was keenly aware of his separation from God, this deep longing for reunion. Man at that time actually saw the physical world as an illusion, as Maya. Right? The spiritual world was my real home. Right? This was a time when man banded together in very small tribes, clans, families, small groups, and there was a chief or a village elder who was responsible for everything. The laws were, or expectations set by the chief were religious or spiritual laws. Everyone participated together. The most important thing was the ongoing life of the tribe or the clan. There was no idea that anyone had any individuality or rights other than making sure that the group survived. And so the concepts really of religion, of law, economics, if you will, they were all completely intertwined. And so we have this experience here of, I'll call it the cultural life or religious life, the rights life, and the economics life are all just together, no separation between them. People at this time had a really deep empathy for people, nature, and the world around them, but the sense was intuitive. It was not conscious in the way that we're conscious today. It was an innate connection with the physical world. Man at this point had to confront the reality of his separation for the spiritual world. And so sometimes this is described as the period, the mystery of the abyss. Man recognizes this deep chasm that's separating him now in this physical plane from what he experienced very recently in the spiritual world. So time goes on, and we have a new period that comes into play here. Again, one that we might choose to describe as a Babylonian period. Man at this point is still uncomfortable with the physical world, but he's beginning to get a sense that there may be some things of value that are present in this, this physical world. Man begins to understand that the world is a stage, if you will. It's a place where he can be active. He can do things. At this point, man is aware of and in control of his physical being. He's a farmer. He's beginning to just scratch the surface of the earth and penetrate it and put seeds in the ground and beginning to do a little bit of planting and so on. Here, it's pretty much nomadic life, taking advantage of what's found on the earth, but no real penetration of the earth at all. People at this point live in a little bit larger groupings that are possible because of farming. And so it's no longer just the clan or the family or the tribe, but it could be a small village that's taking place. So it's no longer just blood ties, but slightly larger communities. This is sometimes referred to as the mystery of polarity. I've got a foot in each world, right? So I'm still connected with the spiritual world, longing to return, but I'm beginning to get grounded here and be active in the earth. Okay? So time continues to pass. And each of these periods is, 2,500 years or something. I mean, it's a long time. We go on again a little bit more, and we see an Egyptian period. And you don't have to, these are titles that Steiner gave to the periods, but they're more helpful to us just as a picture of what's going on, and we can kind of relate to people of certain historic times and see the development. But think about what was happening in Egypt. This is the period of the birth of geometry, the science of the earth and the heavens. We have religious men who were actually the wise men. They were the people who understood how the earth and the heavens worked, right? They were the masters of the seasons and the stars. The spirit was beginning to be worked into matter, but with the purpose of understanding, how will this affect me, right? We have, organizationally, if you will, government-wise, we begin to see kings and pharaohs. The pharaohs were actually god kings, if you will, and they were separate from the priests. So we're beginning to see a little bit of specialization happening in this cultural realm, right, where the heads of government are splitting out a little bit from the purely religious people. Now, we said before that man was beginning increasingly to see himself as an actor on a stage. And one of the things that those of you who've done acting recognize is that you get out there and you work with it a little bit in the way the stage is set up, and you begin to realize that, no, you know, I'm crossing stage right and that's really not working. I want the chair on the left side of the stage instead, and we can make changes to suit ourselves. So too does man begin to recognize that he can change the physical world to suit himself. And so what do we see happening in Egypt? We see man beginning to build irrigation systems, right? Cities. We begin to enjoy art and culture. There's this ability now to subdue the natural world, to change things to suit ourselves. So we see an elaborate irrigation system being built along the Nile so that when the Nile floods, it can go out and flood all of the fields and allow much larger growth of crops to take place. So we're changing the physical world to serve us. Very different from the experience here, where I'm surviving based on what the world makes available to me, and I have no control, and I really just want to be back in the spiritual world. So a changing consciousness. Is this clear? Yeah? Okay. So this period is sometimes referred to as the mystery of alchemy. So alchemy, what is that? Say it again.
Transforming matter.
Exactly. So where we want to transform one thing into another, so lead into gold, right? And very much so, that's what was trying to be accomplished here in this Egyptian period. But again, it still isn't yet happening in really the conscious, critical way that we try and do things in our times. It was still very much a sensory experience. And so this is also the period where man is developing his sentient soul, his sensory abilities. And so when man or the priests at this time are looking at the heavens, they're not measuring them analytically the way we would do it today. They're actually having an experience of the stars. There's a verse some of you may know from Steiner that says, "The stars spoke once to man, but it is world destiny that they are silent now." So this was the time when man felt that he could connect with the spiritual world and get spiritual messages by connecting with the heavens, with the stars, and so on. Again, just a different way of thinking than the way that we think today. So now we finally reach the turning point. This is a period, the Greco-Roman period. And tremendous change happens from the beginning to the end of this period. At the beginning, we have the Greeks. This is a time where Greek citizens, actually Greek men, were members of the polis, right? So they were members of the political body that was working. By the time we reach the end of the Roman, the Latin period, we have men who are citizens of Rome. So imagine this transformation. What is it that takes place that allows me to go from a place where I'm part of a large group to being an individual? That is truly an incredible change that's taking place in the way that man thinks about himself. For the first time, man has individual rights, right? Before, all of the rules were about helping the tribe survive. By the time we reach the end of the Greco-Roman period, I have certain rights for me as an individual that aren't just about the health of the tribe or the community or the city. Now, what's happening here? Well, in this period, we have the development of the intellectual soul. And so we have the great Greek philosophers who are happening with their various rational thought. We have a situation where tribal views aren't just accepted unconditionally or unconsciously. There's a preference for rational analysis, which helps us understand the world, right? And an appreciation for the beauty of the individual mind. So it's not just group thought anymore. So there's this emergence of conscious choice out of what has been instinctual or traditional. People begin to reflect on themselves and they see the consequences of their action. So the more that happens, that actually promotes the growth of individuality. So we begin to have more and more this sense of individuals. Now, we're also in a time where people have been completely cut loose because of the large social structures that they're living in. They're cut loose from family, from tribe, from clan, and so on. And so we have this need for large social structures, large agreements, laws that will develop our group processes while also protecting the newly discovered rights of the individual. So when you think about this time, if you've visited Crete at the very beginning of this period, you can go and visit some of the temples, beautiful, beautiful granite walls that are chiseled out with all of the laws of the town. Wow, that didn't exist before that. It wasn't because they didn't have the technology and couldn't carve something, but this need to begin to codify what was right and fair and appropriate socially was just being demanded now and wasn't possible socially earlier. Mystery here is sometimes called the mystery of birth and death. Because now man is struggling with this idea of I'm active in this life and I am no longer directly connected with or wanting to return to the spiritual world in quite the same way. You know, Earth's not such a bad place anymore. And so this challenge of how do I move from life on this earth to life in the afterlife becomes a real question. And we see that certainly reflected in the story of Golgotha and of Easter Sunday, this real question about life and death as really being an important issue during this time. So life doesn't stop, history doesn't stop. We move on to another period. So Steiner says the next thing, he calls it Anglo-Germanic. Recognition, I think, that history, society was really moving more into Central Europe at this time. And what do we see happening? This recognition of man as an individual is spreading. You know, it's like a virus. It's gone all over the world. And so we see now the development of democracies. What happened here is that instead of having culture, rights, and economics all together, rights sort of split out into its own thing, and we have big government that makes social laws and laws for individuals, and the church and the economic realm are still pretty much united. So here, with rights split out from culture, religion, and economics, we now have the phrases that we all recognize. Man is an individual with certain inalienable rights. I'm entitled to them, and you cannot take them away from me. And it wasn't just the American Revolution. We see it in the French Revolution. These same kinds of ideas are happening all across the globe at a certain period of time. These people, individuals at that time, are equal in the eyes of the law. Doesn't mean that they're equally beautiful, equally wealthy, equally tall, all of the same sex or anything else. But in the eyes of the law, they are all equal. And that means that they have a right. Each person has a right to have the laws applied to them the same way that it's applied to everyone else. So when we think about our own school organizations and some of the issues that we have with governance, this is one of the nubs where we kind of get into trouble. We all agree that we're going to have a salary structure, but whatever the structure is, it needs to be applied uniformly to everyone, right? Some process that's going to maybe come out with different results so that one teacher makes more than another teacher, what have you, but it's the same process and it's applied fairly. So that's sort of where this emphasis goes in our current time. Everything at this point is being questioned. Everything is examined. We're exploring everything logically. So it's not just this intellectual soul that's happening here, where we have these rational philosophers being very intellectual in their approach. It's a consciousness soul. We're rational and we're conscious of ourselves. We have a scientific method. We use it to get all kinds of new knowledge for the world. And man begins to recognize that if I participate in an experience, it could actually lead to a distortion. Anyone heard of the Hawthorne experiment? There was they were looking at how to increase productivity in a manufacturing plant. And they went in and they turned up the light, right? And productivity went up. Light affects productivity. And at the end of the experiment, they turned the light back down to the same level, and productivity went up again. What is that? It was the fact that they knew they were being observed that actually led to the changes in production. It was self-consciousness that affected it, right? So we have this very intellectual approach that we're taking right now, and we're very interested in being able to measure everything. And the scientific method says that you actually want to take out of your experiment anything that might affect or distort the results, because we're interested in doing things that can be replicated again and again and again, which then proves it's true. Now, what are the things that distort results? Our individuality, right? Our personality, our personal perspective. So anything that is at all personalized, our spiritual world, our inner life, none of those things can be measured objectively and in fact have a negative influence on what we're trying to measure. And so what happens is we actually discount completely the inner life. And this process reaches a point where we actually have, you know, a headline that says, God is dead, or is God dead, I think was the actual quote. If you take this hardening intellectual approach, this consciousness approach to its nth degree, it actually becomes a dead end. So man isn't going to develop any further socially through intellectualism. So this is the point at which our Waldorf schools are born. Steiner recognized that for society to continue to develop, intellectualism alone wasn't going to do it. That we actually needed to work on developing some additional capacities. He named three: imagination, intuition, and inspiration. That those were required so that society could continue to move ahead. Now, if you think about what's happening during this period, we have mercantilism happening. We have the clippers that are going around the world. We have trade that's happening. There's a lot going on. And we have economic wealth that's not being held by the church. Right, for the first time, back here, all of the wealth in the world practically was in the Catholic Church, right? Here, no longer the case. There are empires being founded and commercial organizations that are allowed to accrue vast amounts of wealth. And we actually, at this point, have a separation into three realms. Culture, economics, and rights are now three separate spheres of activity. When Steiner speaks about the threefold social order, what he's recognizing is that in our time, we have three distinct areas of activity that are happening. They're not completely divorced from each other. They intersect and overlap. They affect each other and so on. He's not saying that this is something that you have to believe. He said, just observe. If you observe the world around you, you will see that there are three different areas of activity taking place. Now, we're going to spend most of our time today kind of talking about those three realms and what they mean in terms of practical applications in our Waldorf school. But perhaps we can take just a minute or two to follow this thing through. He says that he, Steiner, suggests that, as I said, this is consciousness soul. And the Waldorf schools were brought into being at this time specifically to work on developing the powers of imagination. And that by doing that, the Waldorf schools and society has the task to actually redeem the cultural sphere, the religious sphere. We have two more periods that are still to come, and he calls this Slavic and this the American period. And here the focus is going to be on intuition, and here on inspiration. So if we've done a good job of redeeming the cultural sphere here, we actually are going to begin now a recombining process in the next 6,000 or 7,000 years. And here he suggests that we will see culture and rights become recombined, so that might think about it in terms of a return to theocracy or a spiritually infused form of government. Wouldn't that be interesting, right? And that by the time we reach the end here, the focus is going to be on, once again, combining these three into a unity, but as a conscious process, right? So we will be able, as conscious individuals, to work towards this sort of reforming of the social order. Here happened, but it was entirely instinctive and unconscious. Here, a conscious thing. And if all of that happens the way that is expected and hoped for, then we return to paradise or the New Jerusalem. So that's a whole lot of work, ouch, in front of us. Let's talk a little bit about the different kinds of the three spheres, cultural, rights, and economics. So, cultural. So what kind of activities go on in the cultural realm?
Teaching.
Teaching, right? What else?
Arts.
Right? Teaching, art, religion. Anything else?
Customs.
Pardon me?
Customs.
Customs? Like religious customs? Social customs?
Social customs.
Okay. This is sort of the area of artistry and individual insight. So nobody tells Michelangelo how to be a master painter. It doesn't happen by committee. It is an individual's artistic insight that really provides the grist for this mill. And that only happens when there is freedom. So the artist has to be free to create. If you were a French revolutionist, you would call this liberty. Right? This is why we say that our Waldorf teachers need to be left free to be artists in the classroom, to really create artistically, to bring the material in a way that actually frees the imaginative capacities that are so necessary for our time. Then on to the rights realm. What are the kinds of activities that take place here?
Contracts.
Right.
Agreements between people and organizations.
Do you
want to
say more excited?
Contracts. Contracts, agreements, law. This is community standards, right? So, and as we said, this is the area of equality. So everybody gets treated alike in terms of how the laws, the standards, the community mores get applied to them. Economics. Third realm. What kinds of activities are going on here? Huh?
Planning?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to say that that's not the case. We'll come back to that. Trade?
Trade.
Okay, so manufacture and...
exchange of goods for our revenue, commerce.
Yep. Exchange of goods, manufacturing. Those kinds of activities. Now, let's explore that for just a second. Light bulb. I can't make a light bulb. I know where to go to buy one. Fortunately, there's someone else or a lot of someone else's in the world who know how to make light bulbs. They can work with glass, they can work with metal, they might have access to mercury. They have all kinds of manufacturing capacities in a very specialized field. They know how to market them. There are other people who are specialists in transportation, and they can take the light bulbs from the manufacturing plant and bring them to Home Depot. Somebody else who's really good at managing a retail store and can make those light bulbs available so that good folk from Prairie Moon can go down to the store and buy some light bulbs and we can see in our classrooms. The truth is that we're completely dependent, interdependent on each other in our modern times. It is really difficult these days to be completely self-sufficient. To grow everything yourself, to manufacture all of your clothes by growing cotton, weaving the fabric, you know, creating the yarn, weaving the fabric, dyeing the cloth, building our homes, all of those things. We're no longer very capable of living in isolation from each other. We're mutually dependent on each other. And it's a recognition of this dependence on each other that leads Steiner to call this the realm of brotherhood. Again, French Revolution, fraternité. So in this Anglo-Germanic period, we have the development of these three spheres of activity. And the French Revolutionists put it very well, catchy phrase, you know, liberty, equality, and fraternity. But this is a piece that's hard for us to hold on to, this interdependence that we have that characterizes the economic realm. It's an important part of Steiner's perspective on the threefold society, and we'll come back to that in a couple of ways during the next few days. I'd like to suggest to you further that decision-making happens in different ways in each of these spheres. So, do we have any class teachers here? Yeah? Okay. So, when you're thinking about your Old Testament story block, how do you decide what to teach?
There's already a story, and I don't have to run it by anyone else. If I have a mentor, I can use them, but otherwise I just decide what would be the best thing, the best way for the children that are in front of me at the time.
Right. So a class teacher spends his summer kind of loading up his backpack, reading lots of things, getting stories, reading background material, and so on, makes a plan for what the day's lessons generally are going to be during the course of a 3 or 4 week main lesson block. And then in the moment, the question comes from a child, or the teacher senses something that's living in the class, and the teacher pulls something out of that backpack that he prepared for this trip and is able artistically in the moment to address the question of the child, maybe use it to address something bigger that's living in the class. But it's an individual decision. You are the artist and you're left alone to decide. Right? Now, decisions in the cultural realm, the teaching realm, though, that have to do with more teaching policy or broad approaches to pedagogy. How do those decisions get made?
They have to go into the rights realm. They have to contact, or they contact their colleagues.
Not quite. Let's say it's a decision like do we want to teach foreign language? Which languages are we going to teach? Is it one language? And are those classes all taught early in the morning before lunchtime? How do we feel about language lessons in the afternoon, after lunch? So those kinds of conversations, they're all about the pedagogy. They're all about what's happening in the teaching realm. What do we do? I would like to suggest to you, I'm running out of board space here, that in the realm of culture, of teaching, that we will have individuals, one teacher, two teacher, three teacher, four teachers, who out of their individual experiences and perspectives, we'll each be able to share some observations about what would be best for our school, trying to make a decision about which foreign language, how many times a week, time of day, those kinds of things, what best serves the school. Each will share ideas, and out of this conversation will emerge something that everyone can get behind, right? So we'll work it through out of individual imaginations, and in the end, we'll be able to come to consensus around one of these expressions, or maybe a shifted expression that has been able to hear what else is living in the room. But it's really still this realm of individual insights that are illuminating our decision-making process. Very, very different than how we're going to make decisions in the rights realm. So, for example, in our schools, we have tuition assistance programs. And every parent is entitled to apply. They have a right to expect that they will be treated to the same process as everybody else who applies, right? But they don't all get the same grant, right? So the outcome may not be the same, but they're all entitled to the same process. Now, if you're trying to set a tuition assistance policy and create one for your school, this isn't going to sit very well. If, however, we can select individuals, a group of individuals, who are recognized as being good listeners, who have the ability to go out into the community and ask questions, and then have the trust of the community to then bring that information back and codify it in a way that creates a policy that reflects what's living in the broader school community as an appropriate process. So you have individuals who go out, ask questions about what do you think a good TA policy would look like. They listen and they bring it back in. And so we need a group of people who are recognized as having this skill, who work together to listen to the community and then act on behalf of the community in trust to codify what they heard. Very different gesture than the individual teacher working out of his or her own artistic sense of what's required at a particular time. Y'all with me? Okay. Economics. This is the land of the light bulb. What does it take to be successful in the world of economics? This isn't quite going to do it, nor is this. This is the area where we recognize the need for association, for brotherhood, for working together. The fact that the light bulb manufacturer is dependent upon the raw material suppliers, on people who have expertise in promotion and advertising, on people who handle trucking and shipping and delivery, and on retailers who make goods available. There's a whole series of people with interconnected areas of specialization who have to work in order to make it possible. And so we end up with this sort of associative decision-making process. So sometimes when we get into trouble in our schools, it's because we may be trying to apply this approach of decision-making to school activities that are really more rights activities or economic activities, right? So clearly, the biggest activity that goes on in our school is teaching. And so most frequently we have individual insight, artistic freedom as the approach that's being taken. But that doesn't mean that individual freedom and artistic art interpretation is the way to manage all aspects of our school. Questions? Thoughts?
So could you say a little bit more about the economic? I get cultural, I get rights, I get the movement of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there was, for me, mentally, there was a jump in when you drew the star and then connected.
Okay.
That I'm kind of missing.
All right. So in our light bulb example, we recognize that the whole process of going from idea to having a marketable product requires a number of people with different areas of expertise to come together to collaborate to make it possible for the light bulb to get into our classroom. There is an interdependence and an association that has to happen for activity to take place in the economic sphere.
So the distinction is between rights and economic is the rights are going out gathering just information and bringing it in.
Bringing it in and codifying it.
And codifying. And the
right?
Economics are... already have those bits and pieces.
Yeah.
Codifying.
So we here, we created rules and regulations that control interstate commerce.
Right.
Right. And so trucks that are going between state lines have to follow certain protocols. We have agreements about sales tax and so on that are all dictated here. So all of those kinds of things that affect how we work together from a contractual standpoint are determined here. We're trying to work to codify our relationships with each other. Here, though, in order to get the product to market, we have a whole host of people who have to work together to make something happen. Has anybody had a fundraiser at your school? An auction, a big soiree, dinner dance. One person, individual inspiration, dictates everything and everyone else follows up. No, you need the people who are handling the music and the promotional person and a whole host of people with different areas of expertise and talent to come together in an associative way to pull off the fundraising event, right? That's a very different skill to be able to collaborate in that way than what's required to go out and talk to people in the community and say, what would be fair rules for tuition assistance? Okay, we've talked to 20 different people, we've got an idea of what's living as appropriate, and we're going to make a rule that says that once your children are in second grade or above, we expect both parents to work. Is that what's living as fair in your school? You know, you have to come up with some ground rules. We might say that younger than second grade, it's okay for mom to be a stay-at-home mom. But at some point, if you choose not to work, then when we look at your family economic situation, if you don't work, we're going to add $30,000 of assumed income, which is what the family really has as potential, to their actual earned income before we do our tuition assistance calculation. That would feel fair in a particular community. Mm-hmm. So you're listening, you're getting a sense of what's fair, what's living as appropriate in the community, and then you're codifying it. Very different than working together in an associative way to create a fundraising event. Does that help?
I think so, yeah.
Okay. Other questions? Yes.
With the star, I can put the school down the bottom on one of the feet, and it makes sense.
Okay.
There are some activities that are taking place there, like on the opposite side, that thinking of the light bulb that have nothing whatever to do with me. Nevertheless, by the time they all connect, I get a light bulb. I can understand in the middle too. There's the school in the middle because we're going out. What do you think? What do you think? What do you think? I can't apply. I don't know where the school is in the first one.
In this?
Yes. Does that make sense?
I'm not sure. Listen.
The school is outside because those arrows, basically where they start, is basically back together. So the school is outside. It's holding.
So it's activity within the school.
I'm just trying to understand the relationship between the three areas.
Mm-hmm.
And they're presented here as kind of equal and distinct kind of things. But to me, it feels like the whole rights area comes after economics somehow. That economics gives rise to the need for contracts and agreements and so forth, in the sense that it's about resources and access or distribution of resources and so forth that gives meaning to a contract or an agreement.
Well, again, though, if we kind of follow this evolution of consciousness, at this point where we begin to have this I consciousness separate from society, then what rights do I have as an individual? Do I have a right to own my own property? Or is all property belonging to the tribe, the clan, the village, the street, the neighborhood? So I'd like to suggest in terms of the order of development that the right sphere came about first because of this developing I consciousness, that the associative or brotherhood nature of economic activity didn't happen until later when we actually had specialization, like the assembly line where I specialize in tightening lug nuts and somebody else specializes in some other activity to build an automobile. That the more specialized we become, the more, in fact, we become dependent on associating with each other to bring a product to market. This isn't to suggest that in the end that order is different or that one comes out of the other. This was really just an exploration of how these three spheres of activity developed over time. From a historical perspective. But what do we see today in our schools is we have this whole cultural activity that's happening over here where we're working with our students. And then we have a place where we have to actually work together through our agreements, right? And then if our school's really healthy, we're reaching out to the broader community so that the excess money that's created through economic activity can actually flow back into the school. So we have here, here's rights, here's economic, the money going out and flowing in, and we have our cultural activity here happening. So it's just that there's an interplay between these three. Any organization may find itself more heavily in one of these spheres than another. So you might say, if I am a school, I think of myself as being primarily a cultural organization. That doesn't mean that I don't have right sphere activities or economic activities going on, but I primarily live and do my work here. If I'm on the land trust, I may be working in the rights realm, right? That's my primary area of emphasis. I may hope to use that to achieve cultural good, and I may have economic issues that get involved there, but it's a rights sphere activity. if I'm in manufacturing, I'm primarily over here in the economic realm. Again, I have laws that affect me and everything else. So I'm never, any kind of human activity is going to be informed by aspects of each of the three realms. But we find ourselves in one or the other. Again, this gets back to what are the one of the challenges in our schools is we like to think of ourselves as a cultural organization, but the truth is that there are very few cultural organizations that never have to deal with any rights issue and never have to worry about funding or economics. So all three are present regardless of what your primary area of business is. We can't separate ourselves from the other two. So too, in our decision making in the schools, different forms of decision making are more appropriate than others when we're making different kinds of decisions. So we can't let the teacher, individual artist, decision making approach be the only one that we use in our schools. That leads to social unrest, to parent unhappiness, maybe to organizational inefficiency. So we have to honor the fact that there are three kinds of activities that are going on in our schools. Now, Melissa, we're breaking at 10:30.
We'll, for these two lectures, we'll break whenever you feel you're ready. I didn't want to lock you into a specific time.
Okay. Okay. So generally, though, 10:30 is what you were thinking? Okay. So what I'd like to do is to just take maybe a couple of activities that happen in a school. So let's say, we'll do something easy. Talked about that. Let's say accounts receivable, collections. What realm does that fall in? And why does it fall in the rights sphere?
Contracts, agreements.
Right. So I agree to provide a certain education for your child, and in exchange you agree to pay a certain amount each month to make the school able to keep its doors open, right? So pretty clear that accounts receivable administration is a rights sphere activity. It's an agreement or a contract, right? What about the development of a remedial program? Cultural? Why?
Because you're developing something and you have to have lots of people who are going to be participating to help make that decision, so it's not just run by one person and decided that way.
So cultural decisions tend to be ones that are formed out of, well, an individual insight, though, right?
Right, but you don't want one person's individual insight to guide
right.
the cultural basis of your school, because then you don't have any of the balance of the three.
Right. Okay. So is the decision about hiring a remedial teacher, the need to create that program, is that one that's primarily led or predicated out of the individual artistic insights of the teacher, or is it something that's directed by the business office? It's coming out of the child's needs. And who is it who's recognizing the needs of the child, the teacher?
The economics could affect it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Love to have, I mean, the teachers can't say, we really need a remedial program here in our school. Mm-hmm. Business manager may say, so we don't have the finances right now to do it, so we're going to have to talk about some strategies about how to make it possible. Do we raise tuition? Do we charge parents an additional fee? Do we cut some other area of the budget in order to make it possible? But the decision about the program's needs and how it's formed and shape really come from the teachers, out of the cultural realm. Now back to that fundraiser, that big auction that we were having. Where does that live? What kind of activity is a friendraiser, a fundraiser?
Economic.
Tell me why.
Because it's exchange of goods and brotherhood, and you have to have a lot of patience.
I think that's true for all three realms, actually, the patience. Yeah, but again, in our example, we talked about the need to associate, to bring together lots of people with different areas of expertise in able to do something like put on a large fundraiser. This is also the area that enables excess funds created in the economic realm to flow back into the school. So it's very much an associative process. Now, in our Waldorf schools, we don't make much. We don't make much that we sell. You know, sometimes we have in our schools workshops that might create candles or wooden toys or other things that we sell in our school store. But by and large, we don't make a product for sale. And in fact, anyone who would suggest that our tuition setting and collecting is an economic process, we would probably have an interesting discussion, because the truth is that all that that money does is allow the school to operate, but the education isn't a product that you can buy. I'm going to pay my $10,000 or $20,000 or whatever the number is, and at the end I'm going to get an educated child who will know certain things and be able to score X, Y, Z. Not the case. They have the opportunity to have an experience, and tuition helps make that experience possible. But it's not really an economic activity in the sense of selling a product. So we have very little true economic activity in our schools, but we do have certain kinds of activities that require this sort of brotherhood approach to be in place to be able to operate effectively. So I think with those three examples, yeah, go ahead.
I just have a question. If you go back to this historical model,
right?
We're in the Slavic epoch.
No, we're right here.
We're in the Anglo-German epoch.
Right, right. So consciousness, soul, age, activity.
We go to the Slavic.
1,500 years. We got plenty of time to redeem the cultural realm.
So we're actually working, trying to intertwine these things that are separated, and that's why it hurts so good.
Yeah, exactly right. Yeah, because here they were together, but it was unconscious. And as man became increasingly self-aware, they began to splinter and separate, and we saw them individually. Now what we're looking for is a reformation of society that allows all three of these realms of activity to be reunited, but in a conscious way, where we can say, I can't operate economically in a way that isn't as supportive as I can make it of all of my fellow men. So we're really operating economically in a sense of brotherhood. That requires a very different consciousness than we're capable of right now. We want to be able to have our rights sphere so infused with a sense of doing our very best to reflect the best of our shared perspectives and to codify our laws in such a way that the rights sphere no longer feels like restrictions, being clamped down, I'm having my rights taken away from me. Right now it feels like a diminishing, controlling process. So we want to reach eventually to a place where all three of these spheres of activity are reunited, but in a much higher way than we're able to get to right now. Society is going through some really intense growing pain, and it will continue for a few thousand more years. Yeah?
Can you give some examples currently where you see some of this reuniting happening?
Well, I would say that there may be some attempts at doing that, but that reuniting is really going to require the development of additional capacities that we don't possess right now. It's very premature to think that we could even try for that. Now, what we're trying to work for, or the way in which we're trying to work in our Waldorf schools, for example, without hierarchy, so that we actually have to work with and meet each other, that is working to develop a capacity for the future. So it's a very real social deed. You know, what does hierarchy do? If I'm the boss, it allows me to suppress you. I can tell you what to do. I can listen if I choose to, but I don't have to, right? It allows me to shut down the others. We're not interested in working in that way. We're looking for decision-making methods that require us to actually meet each other, come to agreement, and so on. And that's developing social skills for tomorrow. That'll be really important for this continued development. So you're going to see lots of people trying lots of things, but it is not something that can be rushed or pushed quickly, just like this kind of development process that led to eventually the recognition of people as individuals took thousands and thousands of years. So too, moving forward will take a really long time. Last question, then we're going
to
break.
Yeah, and also, according to this model, is the crucifixion the turning point?
Well, it certainly happened at that point. Yeah, absolutely. Right in the middle.
Does he consider that the turning point of this basin?
He would say that that is the archetypal image for what was happening in that period. Okay, we're going to take a little break.